But for us, we are not really interested in this polarization, but we are more interested now, what does this mean when you now couple these strange light fields to matter? And when you do this, actually, then this chiral properties of your light actually translate into a chiral or direction-dependent interaction between light and your quantum systems or classical emitters. And one example, for example, is it gives rise to a directional spontaneous emission. So if you think about it, you have your waveguide, where you know that sigma minus porous light actually can only go in this direction, sigma plus porous light can only move in this direction. And if you now put, for example, an emitter onto this waveguide and you get this emitter to emit sigma minus porous light, then due to this fact, it can only emit this light into the right direction. If you would get the emitter to emit sigma plus porous light, it can only emit this light into the left direction. And in this way, in these systems, you have a directional spontaneous emission where, depending on what polarization the photon has, your emitter tries to emit it. It's kind of fixed in which direction the photon has to go. And this is not only valid, this is, as we tested this for gold nanoparticles on such a nanofiber and also for cesium atoms, when both of these experiments, you see this highly directional emission of these of the photons into these waveguides. And in principle, this again, these effects and many others occur in also in many different systems, and we're not the only people who are really investigating these structures and this physics. And if you're interested more in this, we wrote recently a nice review which discusses more in detail now the consequences of such a of this chiral light matter interaction, and also gives an overview over the systems where this physics occurs. Okay, so that so far this is the introduction, so where this effect comes from. And now in the second part of my talk, I want to show you how we can make use of this chiral light matter interaction to make something useful with our devices. In particular, what we want to do is we want to build non-reciprocal devices in out of our nanofibers, and in principle, where you, as where light can, for example, only propagate in one direction. And okay, so for this now, I have a bit more closer look how our system works. So, in our nanofiber experiment, we trap an ensemble of atoms close to the or in the evanescent field of our nanofiber, and in order to do this, we have to kind of generate an optical trap, which traps the atom at a distance of a few hundred nanometers from the surface. And the way we do this, we use for the trapping, we use intra-fiber light fields. So we send two dipole-trap light fields through our optical fibers. One of the light fields is red detuned to the atomic transition, the other light field blue detuned. And then we make use of the fact that the blue detuned light field actually has a much shorter decay constant than the red detuned field. This means now that the red detuned field actually now attracts atoms to the surface, but when the atoms get too close, then the blue detuned light field kicks in and actually repels the atoms away from the surface. And if you plot the potential that you generate from these two light fields versus distance from the fiber surface, you get these curves. So the red curve gives you the attractive potential from this red field. The blue curve gives you the repulsive potential, which originates from this blue dipole trap. And if you add the two up, you get this black curve here, which shows you a nice, that we can get a nice potential minimum at a distance of around 200 nanometer from our surface of the nanofiber. And that's a distance where we still have a significant evanescent field, and that means we can, if we have an atom in this at this position, we can efficiently couple it to our optical fiber. And in our standard experiment now, we actually shine this red light field actually from both directions along our nanofiber. This means we get a standing wave of this red light field, and this means now we get two optical lattices, or we get two arrays of atoms, one above, or sorry, of lattice sites, one above the fiber and one below the fiber, where in each of these standing wave maxima, we can now trap, we generate a small optical dipole trap, which is so small also that this conditional block rate effect kicks in, and we can only load single individual atoms into each of these traps. And to get atoms into these traps, we just take the nanofiber, hang it into a magneto-optical trap, and then we, in principle, we can load the atoms from the mod into these nanofiber traps. And in our typical experiment, we reach, as we trap around atom numbers of around 2,000 in these two linear arrays, which gives us an overall optical density of that light that passes through its nanofiber sieves of around 50. Okay, so now we want to investigate or make use of this chiral interaction to kind of control nanopropagation of light through this nanofiber. So, or in other words, what we want to do is we want to generate an optical diode, an optical isolator, where light can now only go in this direction or not the other one through the nanofiber. And the way we do this is simple. So we just take, we load an ensemble of atoms and now on one side of our fiber, and then prepare all the atoms by optical pumping into this outermost lying state, cesium ground state, F equals 4, MF plus 4. And then the situation is the following. So if you send our light from the left, then it, once the light enters the nanofiber and we look at the evanescent field, then light will be sigma plus polarized. And as a consequence, now we drive here with sigma plus polarization the strongest transition that is available in this cesium atom. So this is the cycling transition of cesium. And this means we can now very efficiently excite all the atoms, and the atoms will, since they are excited, will scatter away the light that propagates in the fiber, and we get only very small transmission through our fiber. So that's quite simple. But the interesting thing is now what happens when we come from the opposite direction. So we send light with the same polarization into the fiber, but once it now enters the evanescent field, we get now the opposite circular polarization. So we are sigma minus polarized now. And this means now in this level scheme, we actually drive now this transition here, which is now actually which is the weakest transition that is available in this rubidium ground state manifold. And as a consequence, now we are very inefficient in exciting the atoms. And actually now nearly no light is lost, and most of the light really exits now our fiber. So that's a main idea, and if you do the experiment, it looks as follows. So if you send light from this direction, we get only a very small transmission on the order of around 10% through the fiber. If you come from the opposite direction, we get a transmission of around 80%. And just to remind you, there's no difference. I mean, we have a completely seemingly symmetric system, just atoms along this nanofiber. And we just send one slide from this direction and one from this direction, but we get a completely different transmission through our system. And when you think of this in terms of an optical element, this is more or less kind of an optical isolator, similar as an optical isolator, which has an isolation now of around 8 dB and a forward transmission of around 80%. So this is also comparable to the standard optical, close to the optical isolator in your. Yeah.
So I'm a little confused. So this works in a low co-protective regime only? Per atom?
No, it works for any regime. As we did it for 25 atoms for technical reason, because at that time the dispenser was dying when we did the experiment. But it works. The difference is the more atoms you put, the better this isolation gets, the less your transmission gets.
So isn't it just a phase in forward scattering if you're in a...
That's a loss. You have direction-dependent loss. If you come from this direction, you have a very strong loss per atom. And if you come from this direction, your light loss per atom is very weak. And in this case, linearly, more or less, with atoms number, if you increase the number of atoms, I mean, if you double the number of atoms, you double your transmission losses of the system. So it's in this sense, it's linear. So here in this case, for the example of around 25 atoms, we get this isolation of 8 dB and transmission of 80%, which is already not so far from what you get if you buy the isolator from solids. Okay, we still a factor of 3 missing in isolation or something like that. But on the other hand, this is one of the best optical isolator which is fully integrated, because until now there are no commercial integrated optical isolators, and this is now more or less the best version you can. Okay, you cannot buy it from us, but that exists. And in addition, as you said, it's only controlled by as much as 25 atoms. Since we are already at 25 atoms, so then the question was actually, can we go to the extreme and actually do this optical isolator using a single atom? In principle, it should work also with a single atom. The main problem is a single atom now has a very low coupling to such a nanofiber, so we need a way to enhance this coupling to a nanofiber, and as it turns out, I mean, we have the way we can actually now use our bottle whispering gallium mode resonator to actually enhance this coupling. So we introduce this bottle resonator and then couple the atom strongly to the resonator, which then in turn couples this atom more or less strongly to our optical nanofiber. And yeah, to remind you, these resonators have a high ultra-high quality factor of around 10 to the 8. And together with the small mode volume we have in these resonators allows us to get the strong coupling regime with single atoms. So that's the first point we need for this diet. And in addition, these resonators also also guide light by total internal reflection. And we also couple the atoms to the evanescent field. This means we have the same chiral properties in these systems. So this means if you send light in from the left, here, and it will enter the resonator, we'll get a sigma minus polarization of light in the emanation field. If you send the light in from the right, we will get sigma plus polarized light. So this is similar to the nanofiber, so we have the two main ingredients now we need to build this. Single atom based optical diode, so the question is, does it really work in the experiment? And yeah, for this now, okay, in this experiment we use rubidium atoms, so we again couple now a single rubidium atom to the resonator, prepare the atom into this outmost lying, again this outmost lying MF equals 3 ground state of rubidium. And okay, and now if we now do the experiment and send light in from the left, we get the sigma plus polarization, and now again we drive here the strongest transition that is available in our rubidium atom. And as a consequence, when we scan now the frequency of this laser, we get this transmission spectrum here. So if there is no atom, we get just this gray transmission spectrum, which is just the spectrum of an empty resonator. But if the atom is present, actually we see that this line here splits and we get two new eigenstates or transmission lines, transmission frequencies, which shows us that we really are in the strong coupling regime for our single atom. Now, interesting question is now again, what happens if we come from the opposite direction? Then again, as similar as for nanofiber, now we drive this extremely weak transition here in rubidium. And as a consequence, now our coupling strength, if you come from that direction of our atom resonator system, significantly drops. And it actually drops so far that we cannot really see, basically see no difference anymore between the empty resonator and the resonator plus atom system. So again, this is the same resonator. In both cases, we have a single atom inside the resonator hole. The only difference is, in this case, we probe the resonator from the left. Here, in the other case, we probe it from the right. And we see a completely different transmission spectrum of our resonator. So this this is our dramatic consequence of this chiral interaction. And in terms of, as I said before, we want to build an optical diode. You can directly see that there is a good working point for the diode. For example, if you go exactly on resonance, you see if you come from the left, you get very high transmission. If you come from the right, get very low transmission, and that's exactly the performance you want for your optical diode. And if you write it down in this performance table, you get again similar values as for the nanofiber. We have a 13 dB isolation and a forward transmission of around 70%. But now this whole system is controlled, by a single atom. And now the question is, since we want to go anyway to fully quantum devices, where really now the quantum state of our atom can control light propagation, then the question is actually, can we do this with this diode? And the answer is naturally no, since the optical diode is a very bad quantum device, since essentially it relies on optical losses. So if you send light from this direction, it works fine. If you would send light from the opposite direction, where it actually should stop the light, then the light will couple into the resonator and the atoms, and the resonator will absorb and scatter the light away. So this is, and if you would prepare this isolator now in a superposition of isolating in that and in that direction or something like this, the superposition would immediately collapse the moment you send in your first photon. So we have to get rid of this losses, and the way one can do this is actually if we extend this scheme and now couple a second fiber to our system. And if you couple the fiber that strongly that before the light, so if you send our light in the backward direction, it will couple into the resonator. And it will start to lose it, but if now this coupling to the second fiber is so strong that the light, then we can take out the light and couple it into this fiber before it can be lost internally. In this way, we can then get rid of the of the losses and actually provide this light a very good, well-defined outgoing mode. And we can now continue to see how this system works. So if we now would send light from port 3, then actually again it will be strongly coupled to the atom, will stay in the fiber. If you send light along port 4, it will couple into the resonator and go out at port 1. And if you look at this, actually it's exactly the principle of an optical circulator. And so the question is just how well does it work in our experiment. And so this is a bit messy graph where we actually try and now measure the performance of the circulator. So we send in light to all of these possible ports and measure all the transmission to all possible output ports. And what we vary here on the x-axis is actually the distance between these two fibers to our resonator, or effectively the coupling strength between these fibers and the resonator. And now I don't have time, but there is a kind of optimal point where this circulator works. And this is much easier to see when you look at this transmission matrix. So at this optimal point, we get this transmission matrix for our optical circulator. So first of all, on the left, there's the transmission matrix of the ideal circulators, which just shows you the, if you send light into input port 1, you get all the light out at output port 2. If you send light in output port 2, all the light will go to output port 3. 3 and so on. And the fact that this is a non-reciprocal device, you can easily see that the symmetry is broken with respect to this diagonal axis of your system. So this is how the ideal or perfect circulator should work. And this is now what we measure in our experiments. We would get quite good agreement. And you see that, for example, the four highest transmission values that we observe in our circulator are exactly the one that you would theoretically expect for the perfect system, and all other ports have a very low photon output rate. And as I said, we can, or maybe I didn't say actually, we can program now the operation direction of our device by change by the atomic state. So this is all done when we prepare the atom in the MF equals plus 3 state. So we can also do the opposite and prepare the atom in the MF equals minus 3 ground state of rubidium, and then again perform the experiment, and you get now a similar transmission matrix, but actually now this one here is kind of the mirror image of this one if you flip it around this along this diagonal of your matrix. And this now, when you think about it, just corresponds now to a circulator which actually circulates in exactly the opposite direction. So, and this means now we actually have a non-reciprocal device or a quantum optical circulator which we can control by the quantum state of our single atom. And at the same time, we have very low or quite low photon losses. So independent from in which port we send in our photon, we have a probability of around 70% that the photon will come back out, or we get the photon back from our circulator. So, and these are the two main ingredients actually you need in order to build a quantum device. So we can control it via our atomic quantum state. And in addition, we have a very low loss rate, so we have a very high probability that we can get back our atom. So in this sense now, this is now a kind of a new quantum device where actually we have now a circulator where you can, which you could prepare in a sense in a superposition of I rotate or I circulate light around in this direction and at the same time in the other direction. And this could, for example, be used, we are still thinking about what application this would be useful for, but I mean, you can think about this, it's a really nice tool if you want to, for example, generate entangled state between photons and your atom and so on. Okay, so with this now I leave this topic of only ensembles and single atom cavity QD and come now to a kind of very extended outlook where I want to discuss how we actually can combine these two systems and to get into a regime where we actually now couple large atomic ensembles to an optical resonator. And the main idea from which we started was essentially we want to combine these nice features of these Wismann gallium mode resonators and these nanofibers, in particular its chiral interaction, in a single system. And the question is, how can one do this? And actually, I mean, there's a quite straightforward and easy way to do this. So what we want to do is we start again with our nanofiber system, where we can, from a mod, can load a large ensemble of atoms into this waste of our nanofiber. And in order to extend this now to a resonator, the way we want to go is essentially we can, since we have here just two normal fiber ends, we want to just splice a commercial optical fiber to two ends of this nanofiber, and this way we actually obtain a ring resonator, which is quite simple, and then we need a way to get light in and out of this resonator, so we just splice in a fiber beam splitter into the system, and then by sending light here on this fiber, we can then probe this optical ring resonator, and we can analyze everything by looking, for example, at the transmission port of this fiber beam splitter. And for the experiments we did until now, we just used such a commercial fiber beam splitter, which you can buy from Newport, took these two fiber ends and spliced it to our nanofiber system. And the nice thing about this fiber beam splitter is actually that it has a nice screw, so actually you can change the splitting ratio of this beam splitter, and this allows you actually to change the incoupling rate, or the coupling rate between this coupling fiber here and your ring resonator. So you get the similar properties as for our Wismann gallium mode resonator, where you can move the coupling fiber away and closer to the fiber to change this incoupling rate. We can do this here by turning a knob. And in this way, we get, at least in our, we hope, we get all the advantages of these two individual systems. So we get chiral and collective interaction together in now in this KVQD system. And yeah, and such a system has now a range of interesting properties and advantages. So, as on one hand, it's highly adjustable. So you can, for example, using this fiber beam split, you can arbitrarily set your input coupling rate. Furthermore, you could put many of these polarization controlling petals into your resonator, and this way actually you could change and adjust the eigenpolarization of your resonators in any way you want. And in this way, for example, you could switch a resonator from this situation where, for example, the polarization of your cavity mode is oriented like this. In this case, you would have this chiral light matter coupling to, you could switch it then to this polarization mode, then you would, then this chiral coupling would vanish and you would only have the symmetric coupling. Or you could actually go to the situation where both of these light fields are simultaneously resonant, then you would have actually a situation where, you know, the atom simultaneously couples to a sigma plus, a sigma minus, and a pi polarized cavity mode, and so on. And yeah, and furthermore, which is also very important, this whole scheme is in principle directly compatible with the way we trap atoms now along our nanofiber, and it also has other properties like this. As you have with all ring resonators, you have all these nice features that you have this homogeneous coupling, so independent where your atoms are, all atoms have the same coupling strength to the mode. And another feature that, which for us is interesting is actually that this resonator has a length independent cooperativity. So no matter what the length of this fiber loop, your cooperativity will be the same. And this is, I mean, the argument is quite simple, since we have a guided mode resonator. This means the mode cross section here to which the atom couples is independent of the length of your fiber ring. This means your coupling strength, which is just proportional to this 1 over square root of your mode volume, then gets actually proportional to 1 over square root of your length of your optical fiber. And at the same time, we are mostly limited by losses due to in this nanofiber and at this beam splitter. So this means we have fixed round trip losses. So this means that actually in this case, the loss rate of our resonator is also strictly proportional to 1 over L. And this means when you then look at cooperativity, we then see that's just given by the square by the ratio of G squared over 2 kappa gamma. This means here you get 1 over square root L squared, and here you get 1 over L, and this cancels out, and your cooperativity is independent of the length. So all these are nice features. So the question is actually, can we build this resonator? Actually, can it perform? And so we did some experiment. Until now, there are no atoms involved, so we just measured the bare performance of our resonator, which contains now nanofiber. And so these are the first measurements we did. So essentially, we just scan the laser across the resonance and look at the our cavity resonances. You can nicely see that depending on how we set now the screw, which sets our incoupling rate, we can easily change now the incoupling rate. And this, for example, go from this critical coupling where we get more or less zero transmission through the fiber to this highly overcoupled regime. And here are essentially, what we got here is it's just the transmission, the depth of this transmission peak as a function of the width of this resonator line, and we can see that this nicely follows the expected behavior which you get when you essentially have no losses in your, as when all the resonator parameters are independent of the losses of your beam splitter. So this shows you that we can very precisely set all our incoupling parameters, and when you look at the data, this is an earlier measurement, we did a more recent measurement, then the best finesse we get from our system is around this finesse of around 125. So I guess in this conference, this doesn't sound too impressive. People typically here have orders, two orders of magnitude more finesse, or even more. But nonetheless, since the atoms already couple very strongly to nanofiber, this finesse is already enough to, for example, for this example of a 7 meter long resonator, it gives us a coupling strength to the atoms of around 1 megahertz. And with the other quantities of our system, this gives us already, would give us in this system already a cooperativity for a single atom of around 1.6. When we assume that the atom is just at the standard trapping distance that we have already for our nanofiber system. So even with this very low finesse, we can get into this regime of strong coupling already for a single atom. And then the other point is we can now actually trap many more than a single atom to the system. So now I just plot here now how well we think, how well our system should perform if we assume that we can trap around 2,000 atoms as we do in our standard experiment in this resonator. So this means we will get a collective cooperativity of around 3,000 for this case. And here we see now the length dependence of these parameters. You can see that, as I said, the collective cooperativity stays constant since it doesn't depend on the length. And all the other parameters, that the free spectral range and the resonator loss rates go down with 1 over L, and your collective coupling strength goes down with 1 over square root of L. So exactly the behavior that we expect, except if you go now to very large resonator length at some point, you see that also your collective cooperativity will go down, since we have at some point also the absorption losses in the fiber take over, and you will at some point you will, will leave this regime when you go to a resonator longer than 100 meter. And now they it's not so well visible. So for us, the interesting regime is now actually when, what happens when you go beyond this point here, where the collective cooperativity and your free spectral range cross. So that's actually the point where your cooperativity gets larger than the free spectral range. So this means now at the same point time your atoms are resonant or will strongly interact with two different cavity modes. And in principle, also, this is the same trick that Andrew Hauch showed us 2 days ago. Essentially, if you make a resonator long enough, at some point these two quantities will cross, and from this moment on, everywhere here, your collective coupling strength is actually larger than your free spectral range. And that's essentially now where we are aiming for. So we want to actually now do physics in this regime. And one point that, I mean, we are now roughly aiming for is, for example, a nice length we thought of would be like, if you use a fiber of around 100 meters, we will get now into a regime where, for example, we get a collective coupling strength of around 50 meters, and at the same time, the free spectral range of our system is only 2.5 megahertz. This means now we can couple to a large number of optical resonator modes at the same time, and yeah, and let's hope, when we hope we can do cool physics with this system. But I also should mention that also here, that in this regime already our the length of a resonator already approaches very small values on the order of around 10 kilohertz, which one can also think of that this could open another interesting areas of physics, and it also has a few drawbacks, like as we said before, when you want to couple atoms or stabilize your coupling of your lasers and everything to the resonator. And then in the spirit of this conference, I just have to now put an outlook for the outlook slides. So what do we want to do, or what we think is interesting in the system? So on the one hand, I mean, we want to use this in order to study now this chiral light matter action in down the regime where you have many atoms that can now interact with each other in this regime. In particular, we want to see, in principle, you don't expect in this chiral systems, actually, you do not expect that a super or sub-radiant state actually can form in these states, because the atoms can only interact with each other in one direction. In principle, this prevents the atoms on the left side to actually knowing what the atoms on the right side do, and then since all this collective physics should be strongly modified. And then also in this sense, since, I mean, this collective enhancement of coupling is also always typically explained as in KVQT, is also typically explained always as a kind of super radiant phenomenon. You can also ask what does this have for consequences when you consider now collective coupling of the atoms to this resonator mode. And yeah, and another field which maybe would be interesting also to look at is actually once you are in this multimode zone coupling regime, you enter now a kind of non-Markovian physics where you're, when you typically think of atom cavity interaction, and typically you say once an atom emits a photon, and then this photon is immediately everywhere in your resonator, at least the way you treat it mathematically. And this is definitely not true once you are in this multimode regime, because then essentially the atom will emit a photon, but this photon will propagate as a pulse. It will be in a superposition of many cavity modes, and this corresponds now to a pulse circulating in your resonator. And so the question is how, is this interesting? And also, as Hans Bichler showed, that maybe this could be interesting also to generate interesting entangled states, maybe of the photons inside our resonator. And as a last point, also, we in this system now we have our atoms coupled to a range of different cavity modes. And this makes it maybe also interesting in terms of quantum simulation application, as Jonathan Simon and Ben Leff already mentioned, or and also other people a few times in this conference. But where the main difference in our case now, we have longitudinal cavity modes, in contrast to what most people here talk about are transversal modes. And with this, I come to the end of my talk. So I just want to mention all the people who did all the work. So this work was done in the Rauschenbeutel group in Vienna, and the work of concerning this experiment was done on one hand by our nanofiber team, which is led by Philipp Schneeweis, and the work was done by Bernhard Albrecht, Clément Serin, and Rudolf Mitsch. And on the other hand, the cavity experiments I showed you were more or less mostly done by Elisa Will, Michael Scheucher, Adel Dilipo, and our two former students, Christian Junge and Daniel Schier. And by the way, and if you are interested in this kind of physics, we are currently looking for PhDs or postdocs, so please apply or contact us, and then we will hopefully arrange a meeting. And this, with this, thank you for your attention. Yep.
So in terms of this chiral interaction for like a practical isolator, could you imagine taking one of these fibers and putting it in a vapor cell and just like coating one side enough that the atoms can't go over that side of the fibers? Would that actually just give you an optical isolator?
Yes, but the problem is this coating one side of the fiber will absorb the light. But you could do it if you think of not, if you don't use a fiber, let's say you use a surface waveguide, you have this automatically, there would be only one side, for example, then this would work, yes. And I mean, the only problem is you would have to prepare the atom. As the point of this circulator is, it's this, the internal state of the atom that defines this circulator. You would have to spin polarize your atoms in a well defined ground state, but then this would work. You could also do it with magnetic. I mean, our main selling point always was we can do it without a magnetic field. But if you would use a strong magnetic field, you can also polarize them. But then it's not so different to a standard isolator, since you again have magnetic fields.
So going back to this atoms making a diode in the waveguide geometry, shouldn't there be some kind of critical coupling criteria? Because if gamma 1d is much larger than the loss rates, then you just have pure phase shift?
Yeah, okay, yes.
So one has to match the collective gamma 1d with the free space decay rates, and then one could in principle get a critical coupling criteria where you have 100%.
collective gamma 1d, no.
So, and let maybe pose it as a question: where can this become 100% for a given single atom cooperativity? And
I mean, say for that. I mean, yes, you can. I mean, but you want critical coupling essentially of the system. You want it to perfectly absorb. So, for example, with the resonator, we are close to this point. Just for technical problems, we didn't fully get to this point. But in principle, yes. If you critically couple, then all the light that comes from one direction will be absorbed by the ensemble or the resonator. You can get to zero backward transmission, so you have perfect isolation, but then the question is still what's the transmission in the opposite direction, since you also want still some light going through in the direction where you should be transmittive. So this one has then to look at more closely what the parameters of the system are. But yes, you can.
So I have a question about the magnetic field that you mentioned before. So it's true that you don't break reciprocity because you have some sort of magnetic material, but in some sense, yes, by having atoms that are polarized, right, and you're breaking a sigma plus transition, for instance, this is the same. Like, you have to define your quantization axis.
Yeah.
So you have, that's how you break reciprocity. So it's like you have a magnetic field. It's just not in the medium.
To break reciprocity, you need a kind of pseudo vector which behaves differently and a time reversal, which typically is in isolators is done by using magnetic fields. Mm-hmm. And in our case, it's actually done by actually using the spin of the atom. But spin, I mean, it has the same transformation as a magnetic field, but it's not we don't rely on the B field that originates from the spin, we just rely on the transformation behavior of the spin.
Yeah, but how do you find then your quantization axis? So you have to. Or like all the atoms have to be in some hyperfine sublevel. Right?
Yeah.
So
optical pumping. I mean, I'm only saying we don't have to apply a magnetic field, and it doesn't rely on the magnetic interaction. This isolator, in the standard isolator, it relies on that the magnetic field shifts your levels of your system, and in this way you get different phase shifts or absorption. And here, it's essentially done by the spin, which coupled to this chiral light field gives you, and then a direction dependent absorption. So you can think of it, I mean, it might be a more technical point, but you don't always want strong magnetic field. Also, here you can drive it with essentially zero magnetic field, or maybe the epsilon you need to stabilize your spin of the atoms.
Okay, so now let's thank the speaker again.